is the General Secretary of the ruling Bharatiya Janata Party, Mr. Ram Madhav, leading light of the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh, the RSS. For our American guests, I would like to say that Ram Madhav is a recent inductee into the BJP. He was earlier the public face of the ideological fountainhead that pushes and drives the BJP, the RSS. Let me invite Mr. Ram Madhav to speak on unleashing Asia's next superpower and how the BJP intends to do this. Ladies and gentlemen, can we have a round of applause for our next speaker, Mr. Ram Madhav.
Thank you, Rahul. Thank you, Mr. Arun Puri, for extending me this honor. I came here primarily for some other reason, but I am happy that I have been given this opportunity to speak to you on a very important topic. Friends, Prime Minister Modi is expected to arrive in India in a few hours from now. And in New Year. and as Mr. Cohen mentioned a little while ago, there is a palpable enthusiasm everywhere to be seen in this country. Prime Minister Modi is coming here after a great electoral victory 3 months ago in India. World's largest democracy with a large young population has handed down a handsome victory to him. It was a decisive mandate in favor of a stable and secure government, and more importantly, for a change in our country. This mandate for Prime Minister Modi has a major component of young electorate in India, which has seen in him the kind of leader who is capable of ushering in the change that they are eagerly looking for. In that sense, Prime Minister Modi represents the young and aspirational India. It's not unfair to recollect Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi when he visited this country in 1987, addressing the joint session here, in DC. He described India as an ancient country, but a young population. We are a youthful country. Naturally, like any other young population in the world, our population, which demographers say 60% of India's 1.2 billion people, is below 35 years of age. By Indian standards, 45 years is also considered young. Going by that standards, I think 70-75% of our population is below 45 years of age. It is young, it is energetic, but also it is restless. Prime Minister Modi represents that young, energetic, in a way restless for change India. He is coming here just as he has gone to Japan. He met with a number of world leaders in the last 3 months. It's not an exaggeration to say that his elevation to the prime ministership of our country has created so much enthusiasm in the countries all over the world that not a single week passes in India without one leader or the other from some country in the world visiting Delhi and meeting with our Prime Minister or Foreign Minister. He has set certain priorities for his governance. First of them was to create a responsive government, a government that is accountable, that works for the people, and that works for the last man in our country. And in the last few months, we have seen a change towards that happening in our functioning of our governments. You have a more responsive bureaucracy in India today. You have more responsive ministries in India today. Even some of the foreign friends who come to India tell us that they see some difference in the way government of India functions today. But the second most important priority for Prime Minister Modi is to really make the ordinary Indian rich and prosperous. It's one thing to talk about GDP. It's another thing to talk about growth rate. But it is most important to ensure that the development reaches to the last man. He single-mindedly focused to ensure that the fruits of development reach to the ordinary Indians. Towards that end, he has launched several programs. They may look very ordinary and simple from outside, but I can say that it is these programs that will set the basics of Indian economy right, that will enhance the purchasing power of an average Indian in India today, that will create an atmosphere in India where economic activity can happen with ease, without big difficulty. Whether it is an emphasis on skill creation or an effort for economic inclusiveness or a very ordinary sounding thing like Clean India. These are certain basic things that will change the entire environment in India, thus helping propel good growth across the board. While setting house in order back home in India, Prime Minister Modi also wishes to seek support and help from all over the world in his endeavor to create a strong economy in India. With that objective in mind, he went to Japan. When we had visitors like President Xi Jinping of China in India, he again pursued this objective. When he comes here to the US today, that will be one of the main agenda items on the table. Now the question of defining relationships. We consider every relationship a defining one for various reasons. We want to have good relations with a number of countries in the world, and America is of course one of them. India and America, as rightly pointed out by the earlier speaker, being big democracies, two great democracies in the world, have several things in common. Economic cooperation, to my mind, is one of them. It is true that there was an environment of not very investment-friendly atmosphere in the country in the last few years. But with Prime Minister Modi at the helm of affairs, I am sure this investor confidence will be restored. India needs investments from the US and many other countries, not in the form of imposed to India. Essentially, we want investments to strengthen India's domestic industry, whether it is manufacturing industry or it is defense industry. Everywhere, we need investments to come in. Towards that, India's internal economic atmosphere will be made conducive. Whatever suspicions investors have will be removed. And India will very soon become investor friendly. But friends, as I said, India is not just a destination for exports. In other words, not just a destination which only import things from outside. We want people from different countries to come and invest in India to manufacture things, propel our industrial growth. When I say industrial growth, we are not looking at only big industry. Today, Government of India has increased the cap on FDI to 49% in defense industry. That doesn't mean we only want big manufacturers to come. We have any number of small and medium scale industries that exist in India. They need investments. They need support from outside world. And you can help us by transferring technologies. India is on the lookout for latest technologies to be transferred. In the area of energy security, yes, we are looking for technologies. There can be technology transfer in green technology area. Similarly, in defense industry, technology transfer can happen to India. So we expect, when we talk about defining relationship, we expect countries like America to open up a little bit. This kind of cooperation will go a long way in establishing strong relations, and Prime Minister Modi is committed to enhancing this kind of relationship where we will have win-win situation on both sides. India and China again have certain common concerns with regard to homeland security. There was discussion about terrorism. We have been cooperating with each other. And the government wants to take it further. We can cooperate on the issue of terrorism in a more meaningful way. But I have one rider to add. India's neighborhood is the epicenter of global terror. It is for the US to review its policy with regard to the entire region in which India and other countries are situated. This whole idea that your terrorist is my friend, but my terrorist should be your enemy, I don't think this can work. Terrorism should be seen as a global menace, global threat. Everybody should come together, and if it is a country which is emanating terror, it has to be seen as one. And the issue of Afghanistan needs to be also taken up seriously. We need to ensure that Afghanistan gets a strong and stable government that does not allow the past situation to recur there. As I said, India also wants to develop its defense preparedness. We live in an area, we are forced to live in a kind of a situation where India has to invest enough on defense related activity. India and US have been cooperating in the area of defense. We have had defense successes going on a regular basis. But also India wants to grow self-reliant, as I mentioned earlier, in defense production area. There also, I think, countries like US have an important role to play. India and US have one very important relationship, that is people-to-people relationship. Nobody can downplay this relationship, because in many areas, almost 4 million Indian population here has been a great bond between the two countries. Whether it was few years ago, the nuclear deal related discussion, or today the immigration bill, the Indian community here is playing an important role. That's why Prime Minister Modi attaches great importance to meeting with the Indian community here and interacting with them, which he is going to do on this Sunday. Last, I would like to make one final observation. Friends, Prime Minister Modi today represents a confident India of 1.2 billion people. It's a different India that you are seeing today. It's young, energetic, I already said, but it is also self-confident. It doesn't bend backwards nor forwards. Prime Minister Modi represents that self-confident nation. In the next 4 days, the leaders of the world who will be assembling here for the United Nations General Assembly, as well as the American leadership with whom he is going to have different engagements, G2B, G2G, G2P. When I say G2P, government to people engagements, you will see a different prime minister who knows how to say no. We say yes also, but we say no also when it comes to protecting India's national interest. So we have a self-confident nation led by a utterly self-confident leader chosen by that self-confident nation of 1.2 billion people. And he is going to write, script a new chapter in India's growth and development. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ram Madhav, for that keynote address. We've spent the last few days here in New York, and the sense we get by speaking to people from outside the Indian American community, those who invest globally, big American companies looking at what's happening back home, is that while Prime Minister Modi rode on a wave of optimism and got elected to office, things haven't moved quite the way that the global community, especially investors, would have liked to. They haven't seen any big ticket reform yet. So while there's a lot of talk, why are we not seeing that translate into substantial action just yet?
This government has been in power for about 100 days or so. And while the expectations were very high, it is expected that the government gets enough time to come up with what you describe as big ticket things. Having said it, let me tell you that the direction in which the government is moving is quite correct. Setting the basics right is the most important thing that the government has to achieve in the first few months. And I'm sure governments are elected for a minimum of 5 years, and we hope to be there for 10, 15 years. And you will see big ticket things coming and big changes happening in the coming months, if not years.
One of the things that rankles American investors and global investors is the fact that there is regulatory uncertainty in India. We saw what happened, for example, with coal blocks. Now that is very scary for global companies. They come invest in India, and completely beyond the control of the government machinery, decisions can get taken which can jeopardize billions of dollars of potential investment. How does your party and your government intend to deal with that?
I agree. It is a challenge that we have inherited from the past governments. There's a lesson in it. Our government will be careful to ensure that such a situation does not recur, whereby the investors are put to real difficulty and the very confidence of the investor is shaken. But as I said, certain things in India are also guided by the law of the land. We have inherited a few things that will take their normal course. There are issues that are before the courts. They will take their, normal course of law will take its own course.
One of the, you spoke of China, you spoke of Pakistan. One of the big differences we see between the foreign policy of the UPA and the foreign policy of the BJP is that this is a far more macho foreign policy, far more assertive. However, let's take Pakistan, for example. India and Pakistan have currently got boxed into a corner from where there's now an eyeball-to-eyeball confrontation and each is wondering who will blink first. How do you see India and Pakistan extricate themselves from a corner into which they've been boxed by this new government?
To be assertive and to be macho are two different things. Yes, our government is a little more assertive when it comes to India's national interests. It has to be. We are here in power. We are elected to power, not to remain as a duplicate copy of the previous government. We have to be different. We are here to protect India's national interests with full commitment and vigor. But that should not be seen as any machismo or anything. That should not be seen as any provocative gesture towards our neighbors. It is this government's way of protecting its sovereignty, sovereign interests. Don't worry, the neighbors also will learn to live with this government. It's better that they learned it quickly. It will be in the interest of everybody. Having said it, we are committed to maintaining good neighborhood relations with everybody. The president of China was in India, Xi Jinping was in India. Our prime minister spoke with him, but spoke with him with frankness. He has not bent forwards. He was firm. But at the same time, he was in a way warm personified.
I'm coming to China just in a moment, but let's deal with Pakistan. Because I'm saying you're boxed into a corner. Could you shed some light on how you see the India-Pakistan equation move from where we are right now, where each side is saying, you didn't invite us, so we're not meeting in New York. The Pakistan Foreign Office is saying, you didn't seek an appointment, so we're not meeting, and each is expecting the other to move first.
I don't know what happened here in New York. I know this much, that Prime Minister Modi is meeting several other heads of countries, like Prime Minister of Bangladesh and a few others. I really don't know the reasons for this bilateral meeting with Pakistan not happening. Having said it, as I said, with Pakistan, with Pakistan, there is always this problem as to deal with which Pakistan you are talking about. You are talking about the elected government Pakistan, or you are talking about unelected, the real power centers in Pakistan. This is not an exaggeration by me. Secretary of State from United States goes to Pakistan, meets with the president, with the prime minister for our president for 30 minutes, 45 minutes, and spends 3 hours with the chief of army there. There are certain realities in dealing with Pakistan. It's a difficult relationship. Having said it, while asserting India's sovereign interests, Indian government will try its best to ensure that, we are not boxed into a kind of situation that you are describing. India is too big to be boxed into any situation with just one neighboring country. Don't worry about that. We will certainly ensure that the relationship comes back to a sort of a friendly and normal one.
Okay, let's come to China. We saw the Chinese president in India. A lot of attempt was made to ensure that the focus stays on India.